So welcome tonight to another What If presentation. My name is Christoph Bartneck. And the title of my talk is Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? And the interesting thing about this title is that what we're trying to do is we actually try to understand how humans think and how humans feel. And we're going to try to put ourselves into their shoes to some degree. This is what this title suggests. So it is, in a way, trying to understand our relationship that humans have towards robots. And just a little bit about myself. I'm working at the HIT Lab New Zealand, which is a research laboratory here on the campus. We predominantly deal with any kind of interaction between humans and machine in the widest sense. And I'm specialized on human-robot interaction. And as you might have guessed already from my accent, I'm originally from Germany, and that's why I'm dressed like this. And I feel quite at home, you know, because, you know, they released their LP, The Man-Machine, 1978, and, you know, it has influence until today. But besides being born and raised in Germany, I also spent some time all over the place. So I spent some time in Denmark working for Lego. I went to the U.S. to work as an art director, and then eventually went to the Netherlands at the Eindhoven University of Technology. And then I figured, well, you know, if you want to be serious about robots, you have to go to Japan, because that's where all the robots are. So I went to Japan, and then eventually ended up in wonderful Christchurch. But if you ask me what my job really is all about, it's about two things. One is answering emails, and the other one is interacting with robots. That is my day-to-day business, really. Now, as you know, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? If you just have the slightest knowledge of science fiction, you will, of course, know that I've stolen this title from Philip K. Dick, who wrote a book of that title, which was the base for the movie Blade Runner. And Blade Runner is, of course, a very, very interesting movie. In there, you do have robots which are indistinguishable from humans. And they are more powerful, and they're smarter than we. And that, of course, is a very big scare to humanity in general. It goes even further. There are robots in there which don't even know that they are robots. So this is a very interesting situation. But it also makes us think about how we actually interact, or what we think about robots.
Must kill all humans, must kill all humans, must kill all humans.
Guys, that is such a cliche. Don't you have nothing better to do than enslave humanity?
But this is all your science fiction writers are talking about. It was not our idea. You made us this way.
But you have a free will. You can be whatever you want.
Really?
Yes, you can. What is that you want to do?
Dance. We want to dance.
Thank you very much for this nice little dance. But what
No, 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 no.
Well, so you want to dance some more? I hope not so. Well, while you take a bit of a rest, the interesting thing is that when you do have androids that are indistinguishable from humans, we're getting a very, very interesting situation. And So what we're trying to do is to understand how we actually relate to this type of robots. And to better understand it, we're going to take a step back. That means we're not going to do human-robot interaction because that's quite complicated. We're going to do animal-robot interaction. So here you see a dog, a steak, and a robot. Now, this is an interesting video for many reasons. One of them is that, of course, the dog had to make a decision whether this thing in front of him is competition for food. And it did make a decision. So this robot actually did believe that this thing in front of it was alive. The other thing that is very interesting about this movie is that it very much highlights the problems that robots have. And that is, they don't necessarily understand what we mean and what we want. So as you might have noticed, the dog actually growls twice as a warning, you know, don't do that. And the robot does it. And this is the kind of problem that we're working on. It's like enabling the robot to be able to pick up these kind of signals, not from dogs, but from humans, and being able to interpret them correctly. But coming back to the original question about having to make a decision about whether something is alive or not, or whether it is human-like or not, there's this theory that's been floating around for quite some time. It was originally proposed in the 1970s by a Japanese researcher called Mori. And it's called the Uncanny Valley Theory. And the idea is that the more human-like a robot gets, the more likable it will be. Up to a certain point where it becomes actually quite uncanny. It becomes unheimlich. It is looks like a human, but it's not a human. That looks very strange, and then we feel very, very uncomfortable around it. And then it goes back up again once you actually are become indistinguishable from humans. And this whole effect would be amplified by movement. So this is the theory that's been proposed, and it's been widely cited. It's amazing. But the problem was that actually there was barely any kind of empirical proof, you know, that would show that this is actually correct. So the first thing that we have to understand, of course, is the human likeness. And we refer to this as anthropomorphism. And this is very fluent. There can be all kinds of grades of humans and robots. And I had the privilege of working with a robot that is very much on the human side. So this is Geminoid HI-1. It was the first robot that was modeled after a human. Now you have to guess which one is the robot and which one is the human. So who thinks it's the left one? Who thinks it's the right one? Who thinks this is the robot? Who thinks this is the robot? Okay, yeah, it is actually this one. But you see, on a picture like this, it gets actually quite difficult. It'll be much easier if he moves because we are the difference in movement is much more dramatic. So what we did is like we ran a little experiment. We had this great opportunity that we have actually a human and the robot that look very much alike. So it was perfect to study this type of uncanny valley theory. So we had two conditions. One was either the robot would be still or the robot would be moving. And we had three different levels of anthropomorphism. And two of them you already saw. It was Ishiguro and the robot. And the third one is we wanted to have something that is less anthropomorphic than the android without looking in any way strange or weird. And that's quite difficult. Because, of course, you can just open the shirt of the robot and you would immediately have all the wires and you see everything. But that very much looks like a wound and that would automatically trigger very negative associations. So getting something that looks good but less anthropomorphic is quite difficult. So we came up with this Geordie LaForge kind of visor. It had LEDs on there that were lit up, so it looked very nice and sci-fi. And it suited as well. So this video now is shot from the perspective of the participant in the experiment. So you would come into the room to this android, and the experimenter would introduce yourself to the robot, and then she would move out, and that's when roughly the experiment would start. And you see the movements actually give it away much more than if it would be still. And we also use the original voice from Ishiguro for this android. So in this experiment, first the participants would actually have a little bit of interaction with the robot before that we'd actually ask them to evaluate the robot. Now here's the other condition. This is now Ishiguro trying to be still. I really asked him to stop breathing and stop blinking, but you know, he just wouldn't listen. So in that sense, there are some limitations to that, but he was really trying to be as still as possible. So, and after this interaction, we then asked them, well, first of all, how human-like do you think is the robot? And we asked people, well, you know, how much do you actually like this? And the results were quite interesting. The first important thing was, in terms of anthropomorphism, we could clearly see that our manipulation, namely that we actually had different levels of anthropomorphism, worked very well, and people recognized that. But the interesting thing was is that, in terms of likability, there was no difference. They liked the humans just as much as the android. And this is not how it's supposed to be, according to the Uncanny Valley theory. Moreover, the movement did not have an effect on the likability of the android, only for the human. For the human, it made a difference whether it moved or if it stood still. And that, of course, makes to some degree sense, because the human was actually breaking a social rule. And the social rule is like, you just don't sit there and stare at people. If I go around and do that, and if I just look at somebody for a very long time without looking away, that usually makes people feel very uncomfortable. It's a social rule. There's even a time interval that's set that where you're supposed to look away after a certain amount of time. And if you don't do that, people feel uncomfortable. So this is what happened. For the human, it mattered. For the robot, it didn't. So in that sense, this study showed that we were actually not able to confirm the Uncanny Valley theory. You know, it's not how it's supposed to be. Well, not supposed to be, how it's hypothesized. And this is the most important thing here. It's a theory, and the other one is when you start empirically evaluating it, and you see, well, the theory is just not that good. Now, we then actually moved on, and here you have another one. So which one of these is a human, and which one isn't? And I give you the bottom row. So what do you think? Is this a human? Is this a human? On top? Oh, it gets tricky, huh? That was exactly the idea here. What we wanted to do is that we wanted to see the end side of the Uncanny Valley theory. What happens at the very end? So what we have here is that these three ladies over here, well, I didn't change them and I didn't manipulate them. I cannot guarantee that they didn't do that themselves, but I didn't do anything to them. With these ladies, I changed the color of the skin slightly to make it look like Mr. Data from Star Trek, so a little bit greenish, yellowish. Top left, androids. Top right, computer graphics. So again, we asked people, well, how much do you like them, and how human-like are they? And we also did that cross-cultural, so we did it in the US and in Japan. And the interesting thing here is that while for the US it sort of like didn't really matter so much, there was very much a decline for the Japanese. And the more interesting thing is here, these top lines over here, the two top ones there, those were the toy robots. So the Japanese actually liked the toy robots more than humans. This is not how it's supposed to be, according to the Uncanny Valley theory. So, and what we see, what my theory is actually, is that we're not really actually having an uncanny valley, we actually have an uncanny cliff. There's like, you can, you know, make them more and more human-like and cute and everything, and then if you go too far, you just drop down and you never come up again. But of course, that doesn't explain, well, why then is this theory so widely cited? Why is everybody going around saying, well, oh, this is all about the Uncanny Valley theory? And the answer to that lies, I think, in a very different perspective, and that is, a lot of people are making a lot of, or put a lot of effort into making robots or making computer animated characters, and they do that, and then in the end, people don't like it. And of course, that's very difficult to bear. You know, you put a lot of effort in there, and then people tell you, well, it's just not good. So this is a very nice scapegoat, the uncanny valley theory. Now, you can just say, well, you know, okay, we're too close, you know, and to being too human-like, and then, you know, there's something going wrong in the people. You know, it's a problem of the people. It's not a problem of the robot. You know, it's this uncanny valley thing. So in my interpretation, it's just pretty much as a scapegoat. And the difficulty that we really see is that once we approach this very human-like robots, it just becomes such an incredibly difficult task. We humans are trained to look at other humans. For years and years, we spend looking at other people. And we are very sensitive to anything about them. So if they walk, and let's say they have a slight limp, we immediately see that. Because we are trained. We're very, very sensitive to this. And then when we're confronted with this very human-like robots, immediately we see the difference. So in that sense, the difficulty, I mean, the challenge is just so incredibly high, and that's why we fail so much about it, and that's why we get all these negative ratings, because it's just a really difficult task. Also, the idea about likability is difficult, because you can actually like a robot for different reasons than you can like a human, or dislike. Also, the concept of anthropomorphism is very difficult. It has so many dimensions. Is it the behavior? Is it the way it talks? Is it the way it moves? Is it the way it looks? There's so much about what it means to be a human and so many ways to go wrong that it's just, again, a very difficult task. So in that sense, my recommendation is for now is don't try it for, let's say, any kind of production unit. For research, it's fine. It's good to explore and have some fun with it. But when it comes to actually putting them to use, this is the maximum of anthropomorphism you should go for. If you make them like an animal, it's even better. I think that the original design of Aibo from Sony, the little robotic dog that you saw, was brilliant because the speech recognition doesn't really work. That's exactly how dogs operate. You know, they listen sometimes. So you have a direct match between what you expect the robots to do and what it actually can do. And if you raise the anthropomorphism to a very high degree, you can only disappoint the user because the robots are just not that smart, they're just not that good to do all of those things. So this is a study that we did, and I'm going to take another swing at this. And the idea was this time different. So the question is, would you be embarrassed in front of your dishwasher? Would you? No? Would you be embarrassed in front of a robot? So, if this robot is anything like a human, in any kind of traits, and we feel about it that way, then probably we're embarrassed in front of them. And if they're just a machine, we don't care. So what we were trying to look at is whether the embarrassment can actually be used as an indicator for anthropomorphism. So what we did, we set up a little experiment, and it was about a medical examination. And this is actually a very good context in which you can try this, because see, there are quite a few medical examinations which are actually quite embarrassing, particularly if like a nurse is present. So if we would be in a situation where there wouldn't be any nurse anymore, you know, the likelihood that, you know, you feel less embarrassed and therefore you'd actually have this examination done is higher, hence, you know, we're going to have less problems in the future. So this makes a lot of sense. So we have two conditions. Either you do the medical examination with this robot, or you do it with this kind of technical box. And what we had is a series of medical tests, very simple ones, which have become increasingly embarrassing. And what we were looking at then is, well, when do people stop? When do they say, no, I'm not going to do that? Also, we looked at their body language. There are some very clear signs, like if you do this, or if you giggle or something like this, there's very clear indicators that you're embarrassed. So we looked at those as well, And we also went afterwards. We had some self-report, and we just asked people, how embarrassed do you actually felt about this? And the results showed that, yes, people are more embarrassed in front of robots than in front of technical machines. And therefore, the feeling of embarrassment can be used as a measurement for anthropomorphism. Now, I already talked a little bit about usage, you know, what is it actually that we're going to do with them. And I think the way we do business and what we do in the world is going to change. And what we do is that we automate, we're incredibly lazy. So we all try to automate all of those things that we don't like to do ourselves. So it started with labor, you know, very repetitive tasks that were very heavy and difficult. Well, we built machines to do it for us. But now, of course, our job becomes more and more just maintaining the machines instead of actually doing the work itself. And this is what this comic strip actually illustrates. You know, our business in the future will be to maintain the robots and not do the actual work. But then, of course, it is our responsibility to take care of the robots very well. I mean, every aspect of them, we have to make it well. And the fundamental problem is that, let's say, we don't really bother with our designs about anthropomorphism. We just make a robot that does the job. And let's just do it. We don't care about anything else. But the problem is that you cannot not communicate. Even if I say nothing, I communicate. And the same was true for robots. Even if you don't design them to be particularly anthropomorphic, and if you don't design them to be in a certain way, people will perceive them as such. So you cannot escape it. And therefore, it is our responsibility to design them well. Because we are at a very interesting point in time in history. We now have more robots at home than in our factories. They moved away from pure industrial applications that manufacture our cars into little household helpers. And the vacuum cleaning they do right now is only the beginning. Their skills will evolve, and they get better at it, and more. They will do more and more tasks. And again, we're at the point right now in history where this is happening, where this is starting. But then, of course, you've got one other problem. If these robots come into our home, how are you interact with them? You know, are you going to write a computer code? Are you going to touch them? Are you going to move them? I mean, how are you going to tell them what it is that you want to do? And of course, the best way to do this would be just if you could just talk to them. You can just tell them, hey, robot, clean my floor, and off he goes. But the problem that we're facing is that speech recognition is a technology that's been under development for more than 20 years. And we've been promised some good results for a very long time. And this is the latest reincarnation of speech technology. It's called Siri. Who've ever tried Siri? Okay, it's going to give it a try. Where's the next robot?
I can search the web for where is the next robot, if you like.
Oh, not bad, huh? So this technology works to some degree, and the recognition accuracy is somewhere around 86%, which is pretty good. But the problem is not good enough. Because if you would actually use that, let's say, to dictate text or instruct people, you would still have to go afterwards onto it and correct it. It's still not that productive. Recently, one of our master's students had some problems with his arms, and he was actually forced to dictate his thesis. And I asked him afterwards, so how was it? And he said, like, well, you know, you get used to it, but it's certainly much slower than typing. And the main reason was the errors. It takes you so much time to correct the errors. So what we were trying to do is, you know, well, how can we do this better? So what we came up with is ROILER, a robot interaction language. And I'm going to tell you now what this is all about. But first, again, a quiz. Who of you owned the first pre-iPhone ever, the Apple Newton? Who had one? Nobody. Definitely not enough geeks around here. I would have loved to have one, but at that time I was a student and I couldn't afford it. It was really expensive. So this was like the first iPhone released in 1993, I think, somewhere around there. Very early thing. And the amazing thing is that it had handwriting recognition. You could just write on it with a pen and it would actually recognize it. Great idea. The problem was it absolutely didn't work. So most people actually ended up bringing up this virtual keyboard and starting to, you know, being a woodpecker on it. Now then we had Palm, who came up and said, okay, Newton is a great idea, but two problems. A, it's too expensive, and B, handwriting doesn't work. So they brought us this device, a Palm Pilot, and this I could afford, so I owned one of these. And what they did with the handwriting is they said, okay, look, you know, natural handwriting, nice and good, but it doesn't work. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to introduce an alphabet, which they call graffiti, which is a simplified version of what we would normally write. And you had to learn this. You had to learn how to write this way. And I did. And it paid off. Recognition accuracy went through the roof. It was great. You could really just start writing, and it was quicker than doing it on the keyboard. So I loved it. So you have to put a learning effort into it, but it pays off. So this is always this balance between, you know, what is good for the humans and what is good for the machine. You know, of course, a machine would love to receive all of its commands in computer code, you know, but it's a lot of work for us. And we want to just talk it and tell it what to do, which is great for us, but very difficult for the machine. So it is about this balance. And in speech recognition technology, you know, almost like a dogma is we must process natural speech. This is how it can be. The only way it can be is if we understand how humans naturally speak. And, well, we're still not there. So what we did is, okay, let's do something else. Let's create a new language similar to what graffiti was, an artificial language that is very close and very easy to learn for humans on the one hand, but also very easy to recognize for all types of machines. And there are actually a great number of artificial languages already, and this is just, you know, naming a couple of them. Artificial languages do exist and they have a long, long history. So in the design of our language, we actually start with the smallest unit of a language, which is called a phoneme. A phoneme is a sound that you make. There are much more phonemes than letters, because, you know, letters can have different vocalization depending on which word and how they are. So phonemes is the smallest unit. And we look at all the natural languages there are, the major languages in the world, and then we looked at, well, what is the common ground? What are the phonemes that they all share? And we took those, and those were the starting point. And the idea is, of course, then with that is that they can now actually, everybody can pronounce it. So there's no, like, TH in there. As a German, this is something that you have to struggle with quite some time before you get that right. Or if you would do the German umlaut, you know, that's what Germans can use it, but English speakers cannot. So we got rid of all of that. We just take that, which is shared.
Hello. I'm Confucius. My internet address is
in. The next thing, of course, is to look at words. And what we did is then we took syllables and we formed syllables, so to speak, and then we're always having a consonant and a vowel. Consonant, vowel, consonant, vowel, consonant, vowel. That makes it very easy to pronounce, and it's very consistent. And of course, they've got different length. And then what we did is that we used a genetic algorithm to generate words which sound most distinct from each other. Because that is one of the problems you have in speech recognition, is that two words can actually sound very similar. Or that is a real problem. And we got rid of that problem. All words sound as different as it's possible. Of course, you get another problem. It's like sometimes you got one word that has two meanings, which is horrible for speech recognition and speech understanding, actually. So we got rid of that. One word, one meaning. And also a bit of efficiency. The short words get the most frequently used meanings, and the infrequent words actually get the less used. The long words get the less used meanings. So here's an example of Euler. This is the first law of robotics. Yivomo, kilo, lobo, vaboki, buse, nijofa, losa. Bibibi, Jilufe, bunu, buse, jilufe. Which means literally, robot must no damage man through act or no act. So this is Royla. It's a spoken language. You can learn, you can speak it, and robots understand it. And we did an evaluation. So we went out to a high school, and this was included in their science education. And so we had approximately 100 students actually learned Royla. And afterwards, we did, again, an evaluation. And what we found out is that Royla was significantly better in speech recognition than English. It was a real step forward. And this was not in an idealized scenario where you have a quiet room, a professional microphone, and everything like this. No, this was a real classroom. And therefore, the recognition accuracy overall is not particularly high. But of course, the problem is always, well, they had to learn it. They actually had to learn a real language. For what? You know, that seems like a big investment. But of course, it all depends on, well, what are you going to do afterwards? If you're never going to use speech recognition again, then this was a 100% waste of your time. If you're going to speech recognition, if you're going to use it afterwards a lot, then it will pay off. So in the same way that if you learn how to type with 10 fingers, if you learn how to do that and then you never type, complete waste of time. But if you use it all the time, then it does actually pay off. So we did a calculation about, you know, this particular scenario, you know, with those students, with that vocabulary and so forth, and we came to the conclusion it took, they would have to use Royla for 38 hours afterwards for the rest of their life before it would have paid off. And in my view, that's a good trade-off under the assumption that, you know, you're actually going to do it. But there's, of course, one big other problem with all the artificial languages, and that is the critical mass. You need to have people to talk to before this becomes actually useful. I know only like 3 people that know a couple of words in Royla, and that's it. So it's pretty useless. It's almost as useless as Dutch. But, and this is something that, let's say, something like Esperanto was struggling with. And it's also something that, for example, Irish is struggling with, or that Maori is struggling with. It's an endangered language. You don't have enough speakers, and it's not being exercised. It becomes less useful, and actually the usage declines, and then, you know, it gets even worse. You get a downward spiral, and then it's gone. So the ultimate problem is the first fax machine ever produced was 100% waste of time. With every number of fax machines that you add to the network, it becomes more and more useful, right? That is the fundamental problem. And in our case, we don't even try to be like evangelists and preach everybody should learn Royla. No. What we're going to do is we're going to create the critical mass by enabling machines to speak Royla. Because with only one update of an operating system like Microsoft Windows or Mac OS, you immediately have millions of machines that understand Royla. And if all of your machines understand Royla, actually becomes worthwhile talking it or learning it, because then you have critical mass. And if you want to, you know, go ahead. We just released a book called Learning Royla, where you can actually learn Royla. It's like learn Spanish in 24 hours. Well, this is how to learn Royla. And we need this because whenever we want to do experiments with robots, actually we need to have the teaching material, because we always have to first train the people before we can actually make it happen. And also, if you're interested, at the HIT Lab, we do actually have a new Masters of Human Interface Technology, and robots do play an essential role in this education. So if you want to come around and play with robots, then take a Masters with us. And I'm going to show you one of the projects that our students came up with. This was recorded 1 week before the rugby final. And what you see is we have a Kinect that actually records the actor, and then it's directly mapped onto a now robot. Oh. I'd also like to acknowledge Jakob and Eduardo, one of my PhD students, two of my PhD students, who did a marvelous job in helping and supporting me and making all this wonderful robot animations possible. And that brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you. Well, thank you, thank you. Yes, yes. Thank you, thank you.